Now,
take your time.
1988, 89, I was working at another radio station and I was walking out of the building, going down the stairs. I was listening to the drive show and I heard Dock of the Bay. Now, my parents from the Caribbean, so we always were listening to black music. Hmm. The only Dock of the Bay I knew was Otis.
Mm-hmm.
So I went back up the stairs and I went into the studio and I said, who is that singing? Because it wasn't just someone doing a cover. And I say this quite a lot to artists, not that I'm in any position to tell anybody this, but there are certain songs by certain artists, you leave them alone, you don't cover them. Do you understand what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Because you could destroy them and yourself in the process.
Mm.
When I heard Dock of the Bay, who is that?
Mm.
And here we are.
Mm. Yeah, thank you.
Because that voice, and I tell you what it was, and you might want to edit this because I can't sing as well as you. When Otis says, sitting here, resting my bones, mm-hmm. you go, I'm sitting here. And you're not just sitting, you're on the, do you understand? You're feeling it.
Yes, I understand.
Oh, sorry, I got very, no, but it was.
That's my gig.
But it was the sign of just the, do you know what I mean? This man wasn't just singing, you were delivering that song. That's what it was.
Well, I appreciate that. I appreciate you saying that. And I appreciate you, you know, getting that. Because every night when I do the song, I get to dedicate it. You know, I get to talk about the fact that it was delivered first 20 years before I recorded it by one of the greatest artists of all time, Otis Redding.
Yeah.
And then by uttering his name, by mentioning him, the level of responsibility, the sense of responsibility starts for me as well.
Yeah.
So I start the song on an acoustic guitar.
Yeah.
And I never forget something that is going to lead to another story in a moment.
You tell your stories, honey.
Where as a kid, again, there are certain voices that would just completely take me by the collar, you know, by the shirt and just stop me from what I was doing. And I'd listen and it's, wow, who is that? And what else have they done, you know? And Otis was somebody that poured so much into every note that eventually, because I had a big hit with the song, because I learned a really great lesson then in 87, and that's just do what you love. If I could write everything, I'd write everything.
Yeah.
But when an artist comes up with something like that, and as a kid, I'm singing it, and then eventually as a young man, I'm singing it in clubs in New York City with the best musicians in New York.
Yeah.
All the guys who did, you know, like the Letterman band, you know, Will Lee and that band, and all the great studio musicians would all go to these two clubs in New York City at about midnight.
Mm.
The best players in the world would all of a sudden show up. Guys who were doing Clapton's tour and the session guys. And we'd all go, like, what do we know? And Dock of the Bay? What key? D? And then somebody would just start
Start jamming.
And the audience response was so overwhelmingly positive every single time that people started telling me I should cut it. I was like, oh, you know, it's Otis, you know. And then I cut it. I'm glad I did.
I'm glad you did.
And then Otis, fortunately, I'll try to make this more concise, but Otis's widow, Zelma Redding, was watching me perform at Showtime at the Apollo. And we had tons of airplay, including black radio, which was R&B radio was, you know, all
because
the artists.
Music was more
really,
segregated then, wasn't it?
It was fragmented in a different way. I mean, it's still fragmented in the States. There are a lot of different formats, but it was segregated in the way that that I found very flattering, which was that you wouldn't hear any white artists until all of a sudden my song came on.
Yeah.
And I love that. So we were getting airplay on the R&B stations. We were also getting airplay on the rock stations because Neil Schon from Journey played that solo on that record, and pop and adult contemporary. So it was four formats. And then we kind of hit a wall where we found these program directors, tough ones, were saying, I don't know, this is Otis Redding. This is kind of sacred territory. And I don't know, I'm still watching the record. And then Zelma saw me perform it on Showtime at the Apollo and wrote us this amazing quote about how moved she was by it.
Yep.
And then all the walls came down.
There you go.
And when I got to meet her, she was accepting an award for the most played song of the year, and it was for Doc. And I said, can you introduce me to her? And somebody brought me over to her. And she's a little woman. She's very petite. And I just couldn't wait to meet her. And I said, hi, I'm Michael. And before I got my name out, she told you who you were. She said, I know who you are. And she put her arms around me. And then she just started crying.
That's a documented story.
Yeah, it is indeed. Fact. And
do you know what? I could talk to you for hours, but we got to wrap this up. Can you believe? We haven't
it's
even spoken
it's ridiculous.
About the book.
Ridiculous.
Very quickly, you've gone from recording Otis to then working with Pavarotti, Streisand, Lady Gaga. That is what you call, that's demographics beyond. You've touched most demographics.
It's kind of mind-boggling. Actually,
when
you say it.
Well,
because... You know, someone had asked me on, you know, this webcast that we had done, you know, I can't remember the original question, but I think the crux of it was, have you done what you set out to do, or, you know, what are the things that you've dreamed about doing? And I said, look, you don't understand. My life has already been so far beyond whatever I dreamed. And when I look through the book, and that's one of the great therapeutic elements of the book, is some of it's tough stuff for me.
Yes.
Some of it was tough stuff to relive. And then the rest of it was, what? I did that? And there's pictures with Pavarotti and pictures with
the
Ray
outpouring
Charles.
Can I quickly touch on Ray Charles? Very, yeah. Very quickly touch on Ray Charles. What time does Michael
do I, do I have to be? Do I have to be somewhere? Is that why? Or? Oh, really? Those other people? Really?
Okay, two more questions, and then I'm going to let you go. Sorry, you have to edit this.
It's live. Live?
2 minutes.
Ray Charles, meeting Ray Charles. Tell me what that was like.
There's another moment where I learned, you know, to follow my own instincts, and I loved Georgia. Ray was my single strongest influence as a kid, and he... knew that from the interviews. I had done countless interviews. And that's our signal. We have to move on. So.
Yeah, yeah. So Ray Charles was a very strong influence.
Mm-hmm.
The funny side of Michael, Saturday Night
Captain
Live, hello. A friend of mine sent that over to me on DVD because I couldn't get it on YouTube
this
here.
This is the tale, Captain Jack Sparrow.
For whatever reason, it just wouldn't play here.
Pirates so brave. It's all over the world. It's about 104 million views.
Yes, I know.
And the Saturday Night Live Lonely Island guys reached me and said, would you do this? And I read it, and I said, I'd love to work with you guys. I really want to work with you guys. But this is just too nasty. And the original versions were so...
And that's probably why I haven't seen it.
X-rated. And then eventually we did the one that...
I could talk to you for hours. Do you know that?
Yeah,
and we haven't even started yet.
So this is the beginning. Part one.
Loves and lessons and losses. Great music. Phenomenal photos with presidents and you name it. I can't even get it all in. The soul of it all. My music, my life. It's by Michael Bolton, who's been my guest on the book club. So sorry we've run out of time, but it has been brilliant.
It's been a pleasure. Yeah, we could do more. Let's do more. We'll pick up where we left off.
I think we should.
Thank you.